Hello and welcome to video lecture series in sociology. Today we are going to discuss chapter 5 titled as Doing Sociology Research Methods from your textbook Introducing Sociology. As you know, for understanding, we have divided this chapter into 8 parts. In the previous lectures on this chapter, we have discussed about what is research, what are various considerations in the process of research, what is subjectivity, objectivity, deciding about the topic of research. We have discussed about various research designs, qualitative and quantitative, primary and secondary data, and mixed methods. And we discussed about various advantages and disadvantages of various types of research methods. Today, we'll discuss about 3 important things: sampling, triangulation, and the process of research. Now, research in social sciences in general and sociology in particular is a process through which researchers attempt to generate reliable and valid accounts of nature of reality. Research involves use of scientific methods. The scientific method is a body of techniques for investigating a phenomena, acquiring new knowledge, integrating and developing upon already existing knowledge. It is a process through which scientists or social scientists make useful additions to human knowledge about the social world or the physical world. The scientific method relies on empirical evidence. It attempts to minimize the influence of bias or prejudice of the researcher in the process of research, particularly at the time of data collection and, more importantly, at the time of interpretation of data and information collected. It provides an objective, standardized approach to conduct research and, in doing so, helps to improve the results. Now, let us look at the various steps or stages in the process of research. Although you can list a number of stages, but we'll divide them into prominently 3 stages. The first stage is formulation and design of the research. The first step in the process of research is formulation and design of research after careful selection of the topic that a researcher is interested to study. The research begins with specifically writing down the question that need to be translated or formulated into researchable form. You choose a research design depending on the level and scope of the study. Suppose, if you intend to study gender inequality, you should identify specific questions that you intend to study, like gender inequality in employment or in professions. At this stage, you also formulate a hypothesis that you need to put to test through research. A hypothesis is a tentative statement. It is defined as a tentative statement that is yet to be proved. It can be either proved or disproved or can be rejected. In this example, you may wish to test that there is no gender inequality in legal profession. Now, you will choose different methods or select a combination of methods to collect data on the research topic. The second important stage in the process of research is data collection. As we have already discussed about various methods of data collection and their relative advantages and disadvantages, depending on your research design, you should be able to choose appropriate methods of data collection. One simple explanation is that if you wish to do a quantitative study, you can measure gender inequality in legal profession by using certain variables to measure inequality and collect data accordingly. Now, how will you measure this inequality? You can measure in terms of quantum or amount of practice, measured in terms of number of cases dealt by women lawyers, type of practice women lawyers are engaged in, how many continue to practice more than a decade, and how many are there among top 10 lawyers. On the other hand, if you want to do a qualitative study of gender inequality in legal profession, you can interview women lawyers. What will you do? You ask them about their experiences. How do clients perceive them? Do women lawyers feel discriminated? If yes, what forms of discrimination they experience? Is this discrimination subtle, that is not visible, or is it open in nature? Such kind of information can be generated only through qualitative methods of data collection, such as unstructured interview, observation, and participant observation, etc. The third important stage in the process of research is interpretation of data. The information that is collected has to be now compiled, quantified if required, presented, interpreted, and analyzed within the broad framework of questions that are being investigated. At this stage, you also either prove, reject the hypothesis, or hypothesis is revised and tested again and conclusions are drawn. While conducting research in society, it is not possible to study the entire population that one is interested in studying. Say for example, if you want to study the perception of women lawyers on gender inequality in legal profession, it is not possible to interview all the women lawyers existing in the society. So, what happens? We use a sample. A sample is used by a researcher in order to draw a manageable population within the whole universe of the study. A sample is a subset of population being studied. It represents the larger population and is used to draw inferences about the total population. It is a research technique widely used in social sciences as a way to gather information about population without having to measure the entire universe of the population. Now, there are different types of samples classified on the basis of how it is chosen, and this is broadly divided into two types, probability and non-probability sampling. What is probability sampling? Probability sampling is a technique where the samples are gathered in the process that gives all the individuals in the population equal chance of being selected. Probability sampling is further divided into different types. The first type is simple random sampling. It means that every unit in the population has an equal chance of being selected as it is chosen randomly. The second type is stratified random sampling. It is a technique in which the researcher divides the entire target population into different subgroups or strata and then randomly selects the final subjects proportionately from the different strata representing that population. The third is the systematic sample. In a systematic sample, the elements of the population are put into a list and then every 10th or 20th element in the list is chosen systematically to compose a sample. The next type is, the fourth type is cluster sampling, is also an example of two-stage sampling. In the first stage, a sample of area is chosen and in the second, a sample of respondents within those areas are selected. Sampling units in this type are generally groups rather than the individuals. Now, the non-probability sampling is not chosen randomly as against the probability sampling. In non-probability sampling, all the individuals in the population do not have equal chance of being selected. Non-probability sample is designed in order to include units within a sample with a specific purpose. The researcher may not have enough information about the population being studied to construct a sample. For example, studying criminal behavior, drug abusers or gangs, etc. So, the researcher does what? He simply contacts whom they can. And from there, on contact, they contact others in the chain. This is known as convenience sampling, depending upon the convenience of the researcher. Now, a snowball sample is another example of non-probability sampling. It is a type of sample in which the researcher collects data on few members of the target population he can contact. And then he asks those individuals to provide information regarding the other members of that group or population whom they know. And then he contacts the other people. A quota sample is one in which the units for sample are selected on the basis of pre-specified characteristics so that the total sample has the same distribution of characteristics assumed to exist in the population being studied. And finally, purposive sampling is a sampling method in which elements are chosen on the basis of the purpose of the study. Purposive sampling may involve studying the entire population of some limited group or a subset of the whole population. Now, since we have discussed various types of research designs that a researcher can use, we have discussed about variety of sample types and various research methods, both qualitative and quantitative in nature, let us see what kind of research design is commonly used for what kind of research topic in terms of its scale, large or small scale. And what kind of methods are suitable for conducting research on these topics within a particular kind of research design? Now, look at this table. It talks of research designs, example of the topics that you can study and the suitable methods to study these topics. Now, let us look at the first column. Now, we are talking about survey as a research design. What are the possible topics in which you can use survey as a research design? Say you can talk about opinion polls or voting behavior of the people. You can conduct a survey on large number of people, asking them whom do they vote for, how many times they have voted, will they vote, and ask about the voting behavior, will they vote for a policy or for a person. And the suitable method to conduct survey on such topics is structured interviews or questionnaires, where you can interview large number of sample quickly and over a long period of time. The second research design is experimental and evaluative research. Now, where do you use these research designs? Say if you have to study educational performance of a small group of people, you conduct experiments by changing variables. Say at one point of time you give them educational support, at other point of time you give them extra support in the form of audio and visual, or it can be plain classroom teaching, and then see the effect of these variables on the performance of the students in the process of learning. Now, what is a suitable method to study such kind of a topic? It can be structured observation, where you spend time observing these people. The next research design can be the comparative or cross-cultural study. Now, again, what are the topics that particularly use these kind of research designs? What you can study by using these research designs? So you can study or compare economic development of different countries or different regions within a given country. You can study health standards of people. You can compare them between men and women within a particular country or within a particular region. You can study poverty levels of different regions or places, and you can also study human development index. And what are the suitable methods to study these topics? Again, within the research design called as comparative and cross-cultural, you can use official statistics generated by government in order to assess economic development, health standards, poverty, and human development index. And finally, ethnography as a research design. What are the topics that are being studied or use research design which is ethnographic in nature? Say you want to study tribal cultures or primitive cultures. You want to conduct a case study on small groups, those who belong to a particular cults, or those who are, you know, small groups which do not provide entry to outsiders so easily. Now, the suitable methods to study such topics using ethnography as a research design, the methods are participant observation, unstructured interviews, or the methods which are secondary in nature. Say you can have access to personal diaries or personal documents of these people. Researchers often combine methods in such a way where strength of a particular method can be used to offset or overcome limitations or disadvantages of the other method. This is called as triangulation. Triangulation can be further divided into different types. The first type is data triangulation, wherein different types of data is collected to generate a more valid account of reality. Like if structured interviews or quantitative data cannot give you an accurate picture of reality, researchers can make use of qualitative data and collect data through qualitative methods. The second type of triangulation can be method triangulation. In order to generate more authentic data, a researcher can use multiple methods. And this type of triangulation, that is method triangulation, can be further classified into in-between methods and within methods. Now, in the in-between type, the researcher makes a choice between two types of methods, say interview or participant observation, as two different methods, and he has to choose in between two methods. Whereas within the method, the researcher has to make a choice between two different techniques available within the method, such as within the interviews, structured or unstructured interviews. Within participant observation, he decides between overt and covert participation. Similarly, there can be a researcher triangulation and theory triangulation as well. Now, to conclude, let's summarize what we discussed in this lecture. In this particular lecture, we discussed about sampling and types of sampling, both probability and non-probability. We discussed about triangulation and its types, and discussed about the types of research design, topics of research, and suitable methods for particular types of topics, and we discussed about the process of research. In the next part on this chapter, we'll discuss about fieldwork in sociology in greater detail and about the works of some famous Indian sociologists. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.